mercy and peace be to you from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. In the Gospel of Luke, we hear Jesus say this today, "Anyone who does not carry his cross and follow me cannot be my disciple." Then Jesus goes on to give a couple of examples of how important it is to count the cost of following him. And he gives the first example of somebody who wants to build a tower, and how foolish the man would be if he doesn't sit down first to figure out if he can afford to finish the tower when he starts off, and if he only gets halfway done and runs out of money, how foolish he'll look and be a laughingstock of his neighbors. Second example is of a king who goes to war. And again, Jesus is expressing how important it is to count the cost, because if this king is going to go to war, he better be sure that he can beat the one he's going against. Otherwise, how foolish to do so. And Jesus wants us to count the cost. What does it cost to take up your cross and follow Jesus? A lot of times I think we misunderstand what that cross is. The cross to follow Jesus is not necessarily some suffering you go through, especially if that suffering is suffering that anybody else would go through. That doesn't qualify as a cross to follow Jesus. Because if non-Christians also suffer it, they're certainly not taking up the cross to follow Jesus, are they? A few examples. If someone near and dear to us dies, that causes us grief, suffering, and it's a very hard thing. But that's not a cross to bear to follow Jesus. Non-Christians go through the same thing. It is great grief and suffering. We don't want to say it's not, but it's not the cross to bear to follow Jesus. Or again, sometimes we go through sufferings in physical ways with illnesses, ailments of different sorts, but so do non-Christians. There are times when we have great stress, maybe at work or at home, but that's not a cross to bear. Non-Christians go through that as well. That's not what our Lord is talking about. Sometimes financial hardships, but again, non-Christians go through that too. Well, what would be some examples of bearing a cross to follow Jesus? Well, your being here this morning is one cross you bear as a follower of Jesus. By coming to worship, you are spending time that you could have enjoyed doing something else. There's a cost to being here. And if you go to Bible study afterwards, that's even more cost. And if you read the Bible, do devotions each day, and pray every day, there's more time expended that you could have been doing other things. That's a cost to you, a cost to follow Jesus. As followers of Jesus, we can't just say anything we want to say. God makes it very clear that we are not to misuse his name, certainly not to swear by his name. He also insists that we not tear down our neighbor's reputation. We can't say anything we want. That's a cost of following Jesus. We are to honor our father and mother. That's not always an easy thing to do. We, as followers of Jesus, are not to hate anybody, certainly not to harm or kill them. In regard to our relationship with our spouses, God has very specific instructions about sex and sexuality, and we are not allowed to do things that others do all the time. We aren't to take what belongs to somebody else, or not even take things by deceitful means. God is very clear about that as well. There are a number of other ways that We have costs to being God's own. We stick out as Christians. When people we work with or friends want to do some things that God says, don't do that, and we don't, our friends or our co-workers might wonder, why not? What are you, a goody two-shoes? Or they may call us worse than that, of course. We can stick out because we're different, not going along with the crowd. And if you want to follow Jesus and take up your cross to follow him, sometimes you have to stick out your neck and tell people the good news about Jesus. I say stick your neck out because we take a risk, don't we, when we talk to people about Jesus. They may think we're weird. They may think that we are to be stayed away from. Who wants to hear that stuff? And sometimes people reject us. Not always, but there's that risk that we will be rejected. There are a lot of different ways in which we have a cost to following Jesus. You know, we talked in the children's time about giving freely, and I've my whole life given the tithe, a tenth, and for a number of years a double tithe. Can you imagine how rich I would be if I had invested that money instead of giving it to the Lord? There is a cost to following Jesus. There's a cost to taking up your cross. Jesus tells us to count the cost. When I went to college, I had a double major. I majored in accounting and finance. And there's no way with those two majors I would not be taught about a cost-benefit analysis. You know what a cost-benefit analysis is? It's very important for businesses. Costs have to be kept under control if a business is to make money. And so costs are very important. You can keep them down as much, and if you can reduce costs, that's a very helpful thing, because the more you reduce the cost, the more there's left for profit at the end. But sometimes it can make sense to have more costs if the revenue will be even more than the cost. If you'll take in more than what you're going to spend, then it's worth it to make that extra expense. Cost-benefit analysis tries to determine whether you'll have more benefits than costs. And we want to do a cost-benefit analysis on our lives. We're not so interested in the financial aspect of it. We've got more important things that we're considering. And we've already talked about the heavy costs to follow our Lord Jesus. They are not insignificant. They truly are very significant costs to follow Jesus. But there are benefits as well. So, for instance, we talked about the commandment that God says, honor your father and mother, but he also gives a promise to us with that. Honor your father and mother so that it may go well with you, that you may live long on the earth. There are benefits to doing it. God doesn't give us these commandments because he likes to order us around. He gives us these commandments because they are what are good for us, because they are very good for us, because there are benefits to living with them. God tells us you worship every week. Don't forsake the joining together as some are in the practice of doing, God says. And there's time involved with that. There surely is. Good deal of time invested in that. But think of the blessings. We come together to worship, and we get to interact with our Lord. We hear his word and are comforted and sometimes challenged by his word. We're built up in our faith as we come together to worship and build each other up in that way. And so there are benefits that come with that. Yes, the costs are high, but there are so many benefits now already for us. So many benefits. We have the joy of being one with our Lord, to have a relationship with Him. Now already we have a hope for the future because of our relationship with our Lord Jesus Christ. We who are Christians and follow Jesus have a peace that the world cannot understand. And there's joy in knowing that we have our Lord now and look forward to being with Him forever. And when you calculate the benefits of our eternal life with our Lord, it's better not just to add, but to multiply. Start off with an eternity in God's presence. It's hard to even picture just a little bit of time in God's presence, but imagine what it's going to be, an eternity with God. Multiply that by the ecstatic joy that doesn't end. Ecstatic joy. Multiply that by perfect peace. Multiply that by God's unending, steadfast love for you. And multiply that by the love that we'll have for each other, which will be perfect. And subtract nothing. Because in paradise, we won't get under each other's skin, will we? We won't hurt one another. There'll be nothing to subtract. It'll be perfect. So many benefits, far outweighing the significant costs that we endure to take up our cross and follow Jesus. And think about it. Our costs, significant as they are to bear our cross, pale in comparison with the cost that it was for Jesus to take up His cross. Physical suffering, for me, hard to imagine. But it wasn't only that. He would take our sins on Him. Such spiritual suffering He'd go through. And He'd have to be separated from the Father in order to suffer for us what was necessary to pay for our sins. Great, great suffering that Jesus went through. And He did count the cost. You can be sure of that. Remember what it was like in Gethsemane? Jesus wanted to know if there was any other way. The cost was so huge. Let this cup pass from me, He says. But He drank that cup anyway. He picked up His cross for us. Because when Jesus had done His cost-benefit analysis, He determined, you are worth it. Living with you for eternity was worth it for Jesus. And now Jesus asks us to count the cost. Significant, yes. Oh, but the blessings far outweigh the cost of taking up our cross to follow Jesus. Do the cost analysis, the cost-benefit analysis, and follow Jesus. Amen. The peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus until life everlasting. Amen.